Royal Talon's Amsterdam Acrylic Ink line includes well over 50 colors. There are standard ones like Titanium White, Turquoise Green, and Quinacridone Rose, plus four fluorescent colors that Talon's names Reflex. The line also includes metallics and pearls, and those pearls are interference colors that appear differently depending on the color of the surface they're applied to. We have the entire line on special sale, discounted by 30% off, and in today's video, I'll show you some fun ways to create with them. You'll find links down below. These acrylic inks are like many paints you've used. The difference is the viscosity. With these inks, they're almost water-like while paint is thicker and sometimes very, very thick depending on the type. While these are thinner than your average paint, they're made that way quite deliberately and are filled with high-quality artist-grade pigment. They're light, fast, and permanent when dry, and if you want to make them a little bit more transparent, you just have to add some water. That way, when you wash them over something, whatever's under them is going to show to some degree, and that's a factor of how much water you add. Now, because these are a pigment-based product, you're going to need to shake the bottles to get the color up and moving in the liquid. Now, I've been playing with mine, but you can see that there's pigment on the bottom, and you also can't see any of the bubbles. Now, I'm going to just shake the copper, but you can see now that I'm trying to make bubbles in here so you can see them. You can see some of the bubbles start to appear on the bottom, and you can see the liquid moving. That's kind of your indicator that the color is up and moving. But if for some reason it doesn't, and I'm going to bring this out, so this color is turquoise blue, and I'm going to bring this one out quite deliberately. If yours doesn't want to move for some reason, you can use a skewer, you can use, in my case, a knitting needle, you can use an awl. I mean, there's plenty of ways to do this. So inside the bottle, you can see that it's got the eyedropper top, and there's an eyedropper in here. Now, I haven't shaken this at all, but all you have to do is come in, and you can feel if the pigment's kind of stuck on the bottom a little bit, and you just agitate it and get it up and moving, and then you can shake it a little bit. Now, what I like to do, because who wants to waste time and product, is rather than wipe this off, it's just a simple matter to tap it on your finger, and the harder you tap, the more you'll get, and stuff goes everywhere. You can go ahead and use it this way, and if you decide that's not enough, you can come back and do some more, and you just spatter what's on there so that you don't end up wasting it, or you just wipe it off. Whatever works for you works for me. All right, so let's just get this out of the way for a second. Now, the interesting thing about these is because they are permanent when dry, you don't have to worry about mixing to get mud so long as you layer one color over another and the first color or subsequent colors have to be dry. So these three colors, this is, what do we got here? Ultramarine Violet, Olive Green Light, and this is Reflux Orange. Now in Royal Talon's world, reflux is just another word for fluorescent. So what I'm going to do, I've already used the purple, I'm just going to go ahead and quickly shake the orange and the orange and the green. Now, you know, if you look at a color wheel, these three colors all across the color wheel, they're opposite one another. So if I mix them together, I'm going to get a lovely shade of brown, but that's really not what I'm looking for here. So again, I'm just going to give these a little bit of a shake, and I'm not even going to put some out on my table. I'm just going to quickly use a brush. So if I dip a brush in here and I start to layer this, you can see that I'm getting green. Now, obviously, these are quite opaque, so to some degree, you're going to get one layer covering up another, and we talked a moment, or I talked a moment ago about thinning this with water. But you can see, and I'll grab the orange now with a different brush, you can see that they actually do make quite a nice layer, and I'm not going to get mud. Now, the reflux colors, fluorescent, tend to be a little bit more transparent to begin with. Conversely, if I come in here and do this, now this has started to dry because these do dry pretty quickly, but you can see that this color is definitely going to get muddy and brown if I start to mess around and put the two of them together. Now obviously I'd have to work at it a little bit more. So the point is if you don't want mud, the thing to do is let layer one dry before you apply ones over it, and then you can continue to layer that way so long as you're careful about letting them dry. All right, so I'm just going to stick these in a little tub of water I have over there. Now, the interesting thing also about these is that you're not limited in many ways by the viscosity or how thick or thin this is. All right, so let's do this. I have some colors planned. So let me grab a couple of tags. Actually, I'm going to grab a tag and a black watercolor page. So I have three other colors here because I want to show you, even though these are thin-bodied, you can apply them with a Brayer, which I think is pretty interesting. So get my knitting needle out of the way. Go ahead and shake these up a little bit. All right, so I am going to put these colors out on my table. So I have pearl white, which is like a white metallic, if you will. You're going to see it the same way on both black and white. And then I have, this is pearl green. Now the thing with the other colors that are labeled pearl that are not white is that they're interference colors. So they're going to look different on white than they do on black. And that's why I wanted to bring one of these out. And then this color is turquoise blue. All right, so let's do this like this. Put a little bit of these colors out. Now, because these are a pigment-based product, that means that they are going, they're not transparent, so they're going to show, that was pearl, this is pearl green. So they're going to show when I put them even on black, even a dark color like the turquoise. Let's put this over here so that I don't run these colors together. And I'm not making art here. All I want to do is show you how this works. So if I come in and I grab some of this turquoise, you can see that it shows perfectly well on that black tag. Now, if this was a dye-based product, then we wouldn't see it at all because it's transparent and there's nothing to see at that point. All right, so let me quickly wipe the turquoise blue off of my little Brayer here, and then I'm going to grab this green. Now, I'm going to put the green on here first. Again, I'm going to get some mixing, but I have colors that are not going to make mud, so I'm not too worried about that. But you can see immediately you get this kind of green look that goes on here. If I come in here, this color is going to be quite different, and it's actually mixed a little bit, but you're not going to see that. Let's grab a small tag here. Put a little bit more of the green out, because this is important. It's when you work with products, knowing their properties makes your process and your success far more likely. All right, so if I just come and I put green on here, well, there's still a little bit of turquoise in there. I didn't do a good job cleaning that up. But you can see where just the green is, you're going to see next to nothing. If I hold it just right, you can see the way that the light kind of picks up on that. But here, on black, it's completely marvelous. It's so totally different. So if I grab another piece of black, and I come back, and I just do this, you can see immediately that that's green. And that's the beauty of interference colors, is that they're going to behave differently depending on the color of the surface that you apply them to. All right, so let's just kind of wipe this up, because it's gotten to be a little bit of a mess here. And then I'll come back with the pearl white. Now, I find this to be a little bit different, and I'm just going to grab my water. Kind of be nice if I was working with a reasonably clean Brayer. New piece of paper towel, just to clean this up a little bit. All right. Let's go ahead and, whoops, grab the pearl white. Now this, again, is a different animal. So if I come over here and I do this, again, it's white on white, but it's always going to be white. It's not going to show as a different color depending on how the light hits it. And then if I come along and I do this on black, it's very, very white. Now it's kind of pointless for me to add it here because we've already got some mixing going on. But if I wanted to bring back this really cool kind of olivey green, it's not olivey, sorry, it's chartreusey green. All right. If you get these and they clog a little bit, you can actually take this apart or you can just stick a brush in them. So now if I clean the white off of my Brayer and I just come in and I start to grab a little bit of this green, now you get some really fun contrast. So the advantage of these is, first of all, that they're going to be permanent when they're dry. They're going to be light fast. And because they are a pigment-based product, they're going to show beautifully on black. So when this, or how this gets really interesting, is when you bring more water into the mix, and I mean that quite literally. When I add water to the ink, or I add the ink to a wet surface, or some combination of the two, it's easy, actually, though these are not watercolor, to get watercolor-like effects. The benefit is that what you put down is going to stay that way once it dries, and now you, again, we talk about that layering kind of thing. So that and how to use the inks with my dip and dab technique are what's coming up next. Here are a couple of samples I made using the Reflex, aka fluorescent colors, and I wanted to show them to you because they are so bright and so vibrant, and they're definitely worth your time. You can get really cool effects with them, but you can thin them down to the point where they're not nearly as vibrant. Again, it's a function of how much water you add. And with that, I will offer one caveat. You don't want to thin these down to the point that you've cut the binder so much that it won't adhere, but you'd have to really go way overboard for that to happen. So I have three colors, metallic silver, I have ultramarine violet, and that turquoise blue. I'm going to go ahead and give them a little bit of a shake. I'm going to do this a couple of ways. I'm going to start with putting some out on my nonstick craft sheet, and then using a wet brush and thinning them that way. And then I'm going to do the opposite, which would be to work with the colors sort of straight from the jar and then put them on a wet surface. And then you start to mix and you play, and suddenly you've got diluted colors adding to a wet surface, and all of these wonderful things happen when you kind of play like that. So I've got a black smooth and sturdy 3x4 page and a watercolor 4x4 page, and this is kind of what I'm going to work with. So I've got a round brush. My water is kind of contaminated, so I'm just going to put some water here out on my nonstick craft sheet, and I can use that to wet my brush. So, wet brush into some of the color, and I'm going to grab some more water, and I can thin this out. And you can see that as I play with this, I can get these colors to kind of move around, and as I said, they're going to be watercolor-like. And now I've thinned this enough that you are going to see less of this on the black as you would if it were straight from the jar, which we looked at earlier. But again, this becomes something that you play with, and you can take advantage of those qualities. Now, if I add more water here, I can really kind of thin these out, and you can see how quickly these start to dry. All right, so I'm just going to rinse my brush to get some of that off, and I'm going to come in to, whoops, that's not what I meant to do. I'm going to come into some of the ultramarine violet, and I'm going to start to blend. Now, if I think I need to get a little bit of water in here, I can do that. Again, I'm not making art here. I just kind of want to show you that these techniques are available to you. Someplace here, I have some samples that I played with. So here's one that I spent a little bit more time with. I used some of the ultramarine, excuse me, some of the reflex colors because I thought it was fun to play with them. All right. Again, I can always bring in a little bit more water. Now, where you'll find that you'll get less drying and you'll have more time to move these colors around is when you work with a surface that's already wet. But it's good to know how these things, how paint reacts depending on what you do with it. And so I wanted to show you both options. Now, obviously, again, you're going to see a little bit less when we start to smush this around on the black. All right, so that's kind of that. Now, I'm going to stick with these colors. I'm going to rinse my brush off again. Let's get a piece of paper towel. I'm going to clean this mess up. Now the difference is, and I'm just going to work on white. Now I'm going to start and I'm going to put water on my surface, because this is going to give me the most watercolor-like effect, kind of working wet on wet. Now, I can put water everywhere on here. I've got my head turned and I'm kind of looking at the reflection in the light. If I hold this up, you can see that there's a fair amount of water. If I could get the light to reflect, there's a fair amount of water on that page. So I'm going to come in again with the blue, but now what happens, you can see, how cool is that? You can get these wonderful bursts that form, and all I did was use some diluted paint. I mean, I didn't even take it straight from the jar at this point. So by working wet on wet like this, I give myself the opportunity to move the color around and blend without it drying before I get a chance to come back with another color. And if I want to, I can certainly come back and I could add more water to my surface. I'm not going to do that yet. I'm not feeling the need, but it's absolutely a possibility. All right, so I'm going to clean my brush again, and I'm going to come back with a little bit of the silver and start to move that around. Now, the fun thing is that I can also spatter here, and I'll use a brush to do that. And when you do that, when you spatter on a wet surface, it's going to wick and bleed. When you spatter on a dry surface, it's going to pretty much, the dots are going to stay just as they are. They're really not going to move. But you can see how easy this is. You know, it's fun to get in here and play and to create these really interesting backgrounds, because you got to have some place to start, right? So backgrounds are important. You got to have unless you want to work directly on a white page, which probably most of us don't, then you need something to start with. And if I think that this color is a little bit harsh, that silver just kind of can be blended out a little bit. All right, so if I want to, and I'm going to use this brush, if I want to come in, I'm going to use, let's use the purple. I'm going to use it straight pretty much from the bottle. I'm not going to dilute it other than with the water that what's in there. So I'm just going to stick my finger out and I'm going to tap. And because my surface is wet, I get all this marvelous wicking that happens. So you get this really interesting background with very, very little effort. All right, so we're going to call that done and move that out of the way. Now, something to keep in mind is that you've got, I'm going to wipe all this up. You've got all of this product out here that ordinarily I would not want to waste. For the sake of brevity, I'm not going to spend too much time playing with it. But if I want to, I can grab any bottle and I can just, let's do it on black because this is completely opaque at this point. I can come in and I can start stamping the bottom of a bottle. I can then mix it in, so I'm getting multicolored things. And I mean, you don't have to use or lose what's here. These are not the colors I want to work with, but I could also dip and dab these if I wanted to. But I am going to just wipe them up for now. And then I'm going to grab the next color group because the thing I really, this is kind of my go-to, the dip and dab. And that's the thing I really wanted to show you. So I'm going to bring in Milk Lavender in the Distress Oxide Spray line. I have Metallic Copper, and this is Quinacridone Rose. So again, even the oxides need to be shaken. I'm going to go ahead and give this a little bit of a shake. So this dip and dab is my version of Tim Holtz's Distress Wrinkle-Free technique, and it's pretty much my go-to. It's what I really enjoy doing. So I'm going to start, whoops, well, we've got some dribbles there of Milled Lavender. I'm going to start by putting some Milled Lavender down, and then I'm going to put down some of the Quinacridone Rose, and I am actually going to kind of mix these up. So I've got colors that are not going to make mud, which if you need a color wheel help with that, then by all means grab a color wheel so that you don't make mud when you don't intend to. I mean, if you need to mix brown, then obviously you mix brown. Okay, so there's my three colors out. I'm going to grab my spray bottle, and I just want to mist this a little bit because I want to, those colors are so opaque that I want to break them up a little bit. And it's generally what I do anyway when I'm working with this technique. All right, so this is a number 8 watercolor tag, and I'm just going to come in and dip and dab. Now, the thing that I like about this is that the results that I get, and I think I'm going to leave this alone, I'm not going to do any more. The results that I get do not look like when I use regular sprays for this dip and dab technique. I find that they are, in fact, a little bit different. So I've got plenty of product out here to work with. I want a little bit of copper up in that corner. And obviously the Milled Lavender is a light color. So if I find that it's getting overwhelmed by the other two, it's a simple matter to come in and add some more. So again, you kind of play around here. And if you want to get a little crazy and you want to add some other colors, you can do that too. All right, so let's do this on the black. Because again, with these colors being so opaque and because they're pigment based, they absolutely are going to look great on the black. Now this one kind of got mushed a little bit, so what I would do would be, I'm pretty satisfied with these other two. I probably wouldn't add another layer, but I would let this dry and come back and add another layer. So I'll do that at some point, and we'll have some photos that we'll post to Facebook and Instagram, and they'll be in our newsletter too. But there's plenty of product out here to continue to work with, and I could use up the bottom of a bottle, and I could do the same thing here if I didn't want to waste what I had. Again, this is kind of getting really blended together. So let's have a little bit of fun, and let's grab, this is Mermaid Lagoon. I'm just going to spray a little bit of Mermaid Lagoon in there, put a little bit of water on it, and now we're going to get something completely different. So let's kind of put this out of the way someplace. Grab another piece of paper towel because my hands are covered. And then I can start. Now I don't want this to be too blue, so I'm going to just work my way around the rest of these colors and let the blue kind of happen. So there you go. You can see how cool this is. And like I said, I find that this look is pretty different than what I get when I use just oxide sprays, or I might combine them with Tim's Distress spray stains or dye stains sprays. So what I like about this is it's an opportunity to get a different look and feel with colors that aren't going to change. Because remember, when you work with Distress or you work with Diane's ink sprays, they are meant to be rewettable. So if I come in and I grab some of this, do this. And again, I don't not use what's there. So I can kind of change this look and feel. You know, I think that these inks are actually pretty interesting. I like the fact that they're going to be permanent when they're dry. I like the fact, look how pretty that is, that I can get watercolor-like effects. I like the fact that I can use most, if not all, of my normal techniques with the advantage of light fast, really, really opaque, and those colors are not going to move once they're dry. So these are Amsterdam acrylic inks, and they're on sale for 30% off at joggles.com.